I tell you to be different and creative and think this way. A much used business cliche. Kayla.
What is outside the box?
You got it.
We're flying high with the wings and talking all things lacrosse. You're now listening to the Outside the Box podcast right here on Underground Sports Philadelphia. Another episode of the allegedly award-nominated, honorably mentioned, now viewable on YouTube, and both of the boys in studio episode of the Outside the Box podcast, part of the Underground Sports Philadelphia Podcast Network. It's KB and DJ in Underground Studios for the second time, and when we pulled up to the crib, I told DJ it felt like it had been a week since he had been in studio, and also 10 years since you've been in studio, but you're here. We had a safe flight in, and I'm sure it was much better than the last flight you took before you were here.
A thousand times better. Awful.
We're getting ready for PLL Albany weekend. We've got game one of the NLL finals to get into. Whole bunch of roster cuts we'll talk about. But before we get started, make sure you guys are following us on the socials at OTBLaxPod on Twitter and on Instagram. Follow me on Twitter at KBIZZL311. Follow DJ at SCS_NextGreat. Check out the website, undergroundsportsphiladelphia.com, because I'm sure we're going to have post-game recaps all weekend long on the website, as well as subscribing to the podcast feed, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. Wherever you get your podcasts, we are there. Leave those 5-star ratings and reviews. It helps more people find the show, helps more people get on board with OTB Nation. And of course, subscribe to the Underground Sports Philadelphia YouTube channel. Hit the like button, click the bell icon so you don't miss a single episode of OTB or your other favorite Underground Sports Philadelphia shows. Big thank you to our sponsors who make this show happen. Tomahawk Shades, the best small batch eyewear in the game. DJ, we have an update on the Tomahawk Shades order?
No.
Guys, no. Tomahawk Shades, what are we doing? Just wild. I'm blaming the supply chain.
Yeah, that's
that's what I'm blaming it on.
They haven't even put my order together.
That's insane.
It literally doesn't exist.
Granted, DJ ordered the entire store, but...
Yeah, that's beyond...
Because when you go to check out, you use promo code USP, you get 25% off your entire order at TomahawkShades.com. Kenwood Beer, the official beer of the Underground. Go to kenwoodbeer.com and use the Kenny tracker to see who's got Kenwood beer on tap in the Philadelphia area. Got to be 21 or older to do so. And, of course, please drink responsibly. And the boys over at Bino Board, DJ got a first glimpse at the boards that we're going to have this weekend up in Albany. You guys can go to binoboard.com and use our code BINOUSP to get 10% off your order from the homies over at Bino. PLL season's back, Deej.
Dude,
it's back.
Couldn't be happy.
We are back. Another PLL season getting ready to kick off. We've been covering it every single year. The wild part is it's anniversary weekend of a lot of fucking things that have happened to us over the last year. Luckily, we're not going to Boston this weekend. Because PTSD. That would be a nightmare and a half.
Just wouldn't go.
I was on my way to pick you up from the airport, and I hit a bump in the road. It was drizzling. I said, oh, shit, here we go again.
Die.
Oh, my God. But it is first things first, obviously. We always talk NLL first during the NLL season. It's game one of the finals. The boys came through. I was just a couple years early, everybody. Just to let you know, I posted the screenshot. I predict the Colorado Mammoth to go to the NLL Finals just a couple years early. We were still in the building process. But the Mammoth are going to the Finals. They beat the Seals to advance to the Finals for the first time in 16 years to take on the Buffalo Bandits, which should be an unbelievable NLL Finals series. Don't know if we'll see Ryan Lee, unfortunately, but you know, Colorado proved that they could beat a San Diego team with a high-powered offense. And, you know, going into this year, we thought San Diego's offense was the West Coast version of Buffalo. Like, they were going to put up goals, they were going to score, and Colorado was able to beat them. Dylan Ward's playing out of his mind. I'm very excited for this matchup.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really going to come down to Max Adler. As crazy as it sounds, being, you know, this is his first, you know, NLL action, but being thrown into the fire like this, like, it's going to come down to possession. Like, we know Matt Vince and Dylan Ward are going to come out and ball out. We know that the offenses are going to do their thing. Defenses are going to do their best to stop. But at that point, it comes down to who has the ball more.
Yeah.
And if you're winning faceoffs in critical moments, you're going to have the ball. So, like, Max Adler, this is your time to step up. Like, do what you did for Chaos and turn around and do it for the Bandits again.
And Colorado's transition entire unit has been on fire this point. Like, Joey Capito scored arguably greatest goal of all time.
No. Like, I saw that and my jaw
dropped.
I couldn't even react to it. Like, I didn't say anything in Discord.
I almost threw my phone. Like, I was blown away.
I'm glad my phone wasn't in my hand. I literally would have thrown it.
I said, huh?
What is that? That's literal sorcery. Like, never before seen.
Joey Capito officially practices the dark arts.
Yes. Yes. And I need Lyle Thompson to be the defense of the dark arts teacher and to do some crazy move that defies that, like, ASAP.
That goal is a top five goal I think we will ever see in our lifetime in either form of lacrosse.
Yes.
Just ridiculous.
Yes. I don't think I've seen a goal. I have not seen a goal better than that yet in my lifetime.
That might be our... we might do a top five goals. I have two off the top of my head in my life of watching it cover. It's that and Rabel's Around the World in the All-Star game.
So glad I have that 2019 tie-dye All-Star jersey. That thing is fire.
That goal lives rent-free in my head for all the right reasons. Ridiculous.
Who did you get that pass from? Because I believe the pass
Will was Manny?
BTB.
I think it was Will. Could be wrong. So don't criticize me if
I'm
wrong.
Don't quote on that, but I do think he got a BTB pass.
Yeah, he definitely did. And then it was just like, I said, huh?
Like, did we really just see that? Dudes are nuts out there, man.
Insane.
That reminds me of, I don't know if you've seen the fifth grade tape that's going around on Twitter right now.
No.
Of the kid who just totally Grant A. Metz it. I mean,
oh my God.
They're man up, crossfield pass, skip pass, all the way through. I mean, goes through three or four sticks, but it was a total sidearm. I don't know if it was more Tom Schreiber or Grant A. Metz, but it was great. And I was like, these kids are in the fifth grade?
It's insane.
Like, I could barely dribble between my legs with a basketball in fifth grade, and I've been playing since I was 3 years old. Like,
that's nuts.
Like, to think about where the skill level of this sport is going, it's unreal. Like, when these kids get to high school, I can't even imagine the things they're going to do in high school, let alone college and possibly the pros.
Like, they're going to be doing stuff like Anthony Rendon did last month, where he hit a home run left-handed. They're just going to switch hands.
Unreal.
They're going to be scoring with their teeth, just like horses.
Like, dude, like, and all, like, the falling goals, and, like one of my kids, a freshman, hit a...
Someone's going to run on their hands and have the stick between their feet.
Someone on Chaos has to do it, right? That is the most, like, scorpion-like thing you can do on a lacrosse field. Like, it's got to be someone on Chaos.
Man.
Who would, though? Ian.
Yeah. See his mom's tattoo. His mom got a championship tattoo before he did.
No way.
Yeah.
Why is their entire family, like, just sick?
Speaking of chaos, real quick, too, before we continue with the NLL final, is Curtis Dixon just not playing this year?
I don't think so. I didn't see him on the roster.
That's such a bummer.
Didn't report to training camp. Might be doing MSL.
Maybe.
That's really the only thing I can think of why he wouldn't be playing.
That sucks.
Because he didn't play last year either, right?
He was hurt last year, so he didn't play.
So I thought he would have came back. So my only guess is...
Because he played in the bubble, just like Jesse King did. Man, that sucks.
My only guess is MSL, because, like, I mean, none of the guys are really playing MSL this year. None of the PLL guys are all playing PLL.
Yeah. Damn. That's such a bummer. He's so good.
Yeah.
And his celebrations are...
top notch.
Elite.
Top notch. Does not... almost doesn't get better. LFG. There's no way she didn't ask AT for advice.
Tell me you saw Joe Keegan's meme he made today.
No.
About AT being mic'd up in practice again.
Did you see him call? Did you see AT call out that play, though?
Did you see AT's son called him mid-practice?
No, I didn't see that.
But yeah, I did. James Towers called him. His phone rang. Andy Towers said, "What's up? We're in the middle of a scrimmage." So Keegs. Said, "When James Towers calls Andy Towers."
Yes. Yeah, he was like talking with RJ, and AT goes, "This is going to be this, and
call it as I see it." I can't wait to get hit in the chest this weekend, by the way.
Oh my God.
It's like when Doctor Strange like astral punches.
Get back to a different time zone. He's going to send me back to Chicago. By the way, I'm sitting in the airport getting ready to board. Kyle wakes up from a nap.
Totally disoriented.
7:35 Eastern Standard Time is the time.
First off, I woke up and I was like, oh, shit. And then I was like, oh, wait, I'm good. Okay.
It's 7:35 Eastern Standard Time. I'm in Chicago, which is Central Standard Time.
Which I totally forget that Chicago is all, like, Chicago being Central Time, it seems like a myth.
It almost doesn't make sense.
No.
It literally almost doesn't make sense. And I'm looking at my phone, it says 6:35, and I go, oh, yeah, like, going to take off at 7:05. And he goes, what? It's 7:35?
Blast from the past? Did you not have service?
No, I had
total That's service. What my brain was like. Did this text get not sent through because the Wi-Fi at Chicago's airport was that bad?
No, actually, ORD, O'Hare, has phenomenal.
Might have to send Wi-Fi. Stephen McAvoy there to record Get in the Hole every week.
Like, I mean, I downloaded 6 episodes of All American in 20 minutes.
Jeez.
While waiting for my flight, because I forgot to download stuff for the past week.
That's clutch.
But, like, yeah, like, I mean, the Wi-Fi was great, but I was just like, yeah, it's 6:35 and I'm leaving in half an hour at 7. And he's like, no, you're not.
Huh?
Like, dog, like, I don't have the brain that AT has. Like, no. I'll tell you that's a smart man.
Yeah.
You'll have to go back and watch that clip of, it was they put it out earlier today, the training camp vlog, and it was a scrimmage, and he's like, it's going to be this, and this, but it's going to end with a goal from this person. And he's like talking it through. He's like, boom, 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 finish. And I was like,
his quote, you play well, we win. You don't? It's when you end up in the fucking player pool. What a quote. What a quote.
And we always seem to know who's going to the player pool before they
get
there.
All the time. Well, except a couple this week, which we'll get into later in the show.
Yeah, exactly.
But the NLL Finals, Game 1 this weekend. We're still trying to figure out where we're going to be trying to watch it, hopefully. The place we go to has ESPN+, because I think that's what it's being broadcast on.
I mean, or they can just have Wi-Fi.
True. We'll pop that thing on our phone real quick.
Yeah, we got laptops tomorrow.
Yes.
We don't need no phone. We need big screens.
Yes. We need projectors. Surround sound.
Do you think a restaurant would get upset if you showed up with a projector and put a game on
the Buffalo Wild Wings here has like two projector TV screens.
Yes.
It's great.
Just imagine like showing up to a restaurant on your own and be like, hey, yeah, I'm going to eat here and like pay y'all and stuff, but like, I'm going to just play the game right here on my projector. Is that all right?
Can y'all switch the TV input real quick? I got to drop in.
Hey, do y'all got an extension cord?
Tomato Town calling my name.
Tomato Town.
We're still trying to figure. Buffalo Wild Wings might be the spot. No free ads. There is a Mountain Dew review there. Still trying to figure it out, though. But we will be somewhere to watch the NFL Finals. Game one way or another.
That is not our hotel room.
No. Although we did get that early check-in, which is nice. And our hotel room, it's very close to University of Albany.
Yes. Which is
even better.
Can't beat walking distance.
It's the best. Colorado and Buffalo, though, it's going to be one hell of an offensive matchup. Like, the postseason this year, Colorado scoring more goals per game. Bandits are allowing less than Colorado is, but it's still, you know, only a goal and a half difference. The PK percentage, though, is the interesting part here. Buffalo's penalty kills at 75%, and Colorado's penalty kills at 16.67%. That, to me, stands out as here's a series swinging stat.
Yeah, that's a huge swinging stat. I mean,
if you can't kill penalties against Buffalo,
you're not going to win.
You're fucked.
Because, I mean, we've talked about it 1,001 times. Like, they have, like, 8, you know, synonymous offensive options. You know, granted, they're split up, like, 4-4 between left and right. But to have 8 guys you can swap through on your power play, and if you can't defend that, you're going to have a very long night.
And they also have a guy named Steve Priolo who can run down the floor and score from their defense.
Priolo is low-key dark horse for Defense Player of the Year.
Yeah.
Like, he's had a phenomenal season. Like, yeah. You can say he's a big part of the reason why Buffalo is as successful as they are.
100%.
Without Steve Priolo, I think that defense is very different.
Oh, definitely.
You know, I think he's playing that role in that position we thought Brock Sorensen would play for the Wings. Like, he's that.
And he's been that for years for Buffalo, which is.
He's kind of taken that general role and plays it very well, almost to the tune of Brody Merrill. Like,
yeah.
Very, very good.
I think the other knock on Colorado is not having Ryan Lee, but we've seen them overcome that. Connor Robinson's been fantastic for them. Eli McLaughlin has been fantastic. Eli had 26 points in 3 games in the Western Conference Finals. 26 points in 3 games. Let that sink into your brains. That's stupid.
He almost had a sock trick in game 3 without trying.
He had 14 goals and 12 assists, I think, was the breakdown. That's dumb. That's in 3 games.
Unreal. And we're not talking against like a slouch defense.
No.
This is, you know, Eli Salama, Patrick Schume, Brody Merrill, and you still got to shoot on Frank Skiggs. Like, he did this against a very talented, very, very good defense, and he made them look like nothing, like chopped liver.
Insane.
Like he's like, oh, I'm just going to do this, this, and this, and then score, and you're not going to be able to do anything about it. Bananas. Like, looking back at that Western Conference Finals, he was the best player on the floor every single time he was out there.
And it was like him and Dane Doby.
And that's crazy to say that he was the best when you have Dane Doby out there, Westberg, Austin Stotts
playing the way that he played,
Zed Williams, like Dylan Ward, Frank Skiggs are in net. That's the best guy on the
field. Capito.
Every single time on the floor, 51 in red/white, black, whatever jersey they want to wear, was the best player.
Can they please wear the blackout jerseys one of these matchups? That would be sweet.
There's only one for them to wear it.
That would be so
sweet.
Honestly, that's got to be at home in the Loud House. And could you imagine if they win game one on the road and then wear the black jerseys for the possible series clincher at home?
I need it.
No way they don't. No way they don't sweep and win the NLL Finals. They wear the black jerseys at home with a 1-0 lead. They sweep and win.
Now we have a big predicament here too, because obviously we have our picks and we'll have our pick segment in a little bit, but we obviously have a bunch of people that we're fans of on both of these teams, and we have a lot of ties to both of these squads. We obviously hung out with most of this Bandits roster when they won a championship in September with Chaos. But Colorado, Dylan Ward, friend of the program, Colorado's Twitter account, follows us, interacts with our tweets. They're an OG follow of the NLL teams that followed us. Where do we let our loyalties lie in this series? Who do we want to see with the hardware and a trophy in the trophy case? I'm so torn.
If we want to be honest here, we could technically break OTB into two separate sections. Because we aren't really doing any wrong rooting against the Buffalo guys.
Right.
If we turn around and root for them when they put on a Chaos jersey.
Right.
But we are kind of doing a disservice to not root for Colorado, who's been with us since day one.
Very true.
There's no real disservice to not root for Buffalo, but there is a big disservice to not root for Colorado.
Yes. And it's one of those things where it's like, not a lot of guys from Colorado have been on the show or have interacted with us outside of Dylan Ward. But their team's fucking cool. Like, they have so many cool, fun guys. Like, Connor Robinson is so fucking cool. I want his nickname of the Mad Hatter to stick so bad. That motherfucker scores hat tricks like no other.
Yeah, left and right. Left and right.
And
three, and then that's it.
Colorado, like,
he's like worse than Ryan Brown. Because Ryan Brown is like one or five or none. And Eli McLaughlin, like, or Connor Robinson is three.
Three or more.
Three or more. That's it. You get zero, you get three, or you get a whole bunch more. It's just bananas to think, like, if he steps out on the field, it's like he scores one, you know he's scoring two
more. Hat-tricks come in like 10 minutes later.
You know he's scoring two more. Like, just like we say with Ryan Brown. Oh, there's the first. Oh, there's four more coming. He's got five of them coming. You let him score one, you just messed up. Same thing with Connor Robinson. You let him score one, not only does Colorado win most of the time, but two, he's got a hat trick coming up in a few minutes. Like, it's nuts.
And Buffalo-wise, you know, Dane, friend of the program, doesn't follow us on Twitter, though. Can we fix that, Dane? Please. Chase Frazier is obviously a homie for life, friend of the program. Tahoka, future guest, eventually. A homie for life. And, you know, we hung out with the boys when they won a title. And, like, watching them win a title, it's very, very fun. And we know Buffalo, as a city, would go nuclear if any team won a title.
Oh, yeah. It would be unreal, especially after what they've been through in the recent weeks. Like, that's honestly exactly what the community needs. But, you know, you bring up that championship hangout that we had. Another reason why it's not really bad to go against Buffalo is none of those guys really initiated us into that Chaos group.
That's true.
It was Jack Rowlett that really gave us that extended hand.
And so then, like, it was Jack, Jared, Blaze, and Austin Cott.
Yeah.
And that, Ian.
Yeah, and
you, well, know, Ian.
Ian is like the one guy we, it's kind of like, it's kind of like,
this a situation where we just hope both teams have fun?
No. It's kind of like when the Riptide play Wings. I want the Riptide to win every single time, but I want Trevor Baptiste to have the best game of his life. I want Blaze to have the best game of his life, but, like, I also want the Riptide to win every single time. As much as I want Colorado to win, I want Ian and the rest of the Bandit guys to have the time of their lives.
Man.
Ball out. Like, I literally, this is hard.
This is so tough. Like, if San Diego would have won, definitively, would have been hoping for Eli Gobrek to have the time of his life, because that's the boy, and Austin Stotts to have the time of his life, because that's the first guest in show history. But I would have been wholeheartedly rooting for the Bandits, because there's also both of those teams don't follow us. And Buffalo, you could increase your odds if you hit the follow button. You're 1 of 4.
Got some other odds you can increase.
1 of 4.
Got some other odds you can increase if you follow. Just saying. Just saying. Those odds are still up for grabs.
Like, I'm pretty sure Colorado is one of the first, like, 4 teams that followed us. It's the Wings, because obviously we're media credentials with them. Calgary, I want to say, was in there. Saskatchewan was in there. And then Colorado. It was a lot of the West Coast teams that came through first. New England, rest in peace. I'm sad that Twitter account got deleted, because there was so many fun tweets, but back and forth.
Doesn't New England's, like, membership just slide over to Albany? Like, isn't?
No, they created a brand new account.
So they're not,
like, the New England Black Wolves account just, like, was deleted. I was so pissed.
So with that deleted comes the deletion of being a part of the OTB crew as well.
Well, I mean, at least Albany follows us.
Yes. Yes, they do.
I wonder if I can still search.
No. It ain't going to come up.
The handle. Oh, yeah, it's still there. It just doesn't show up as, like, an account you can, like, click on.
That's awful.
But that sucks.
What's the point in doing that?
Made no sense to me.
It's not like Black Wolves is trending on Twitter or anything. Newsflash, it's not. That is a newsflash for anybody. Like,
it sucks. Because that was the first, like, Twitter banter that really... Shout out Tyler Brocious. Man, should we just get into our pick segment of the week, brought to you by the homies over at Pickup? One of two this week. You guys can go to playpickup.com, start playing the hottest headlines in sports, rack up points on your fan profiles, cash them in for prizes on the Pickup Marketplace, playpickup.com. Our NLL Finals Game 1 pick of the week. DJ, the Bandits, hosting the Mammoth, 7:30 p.m. Eastern time in a fully loaded day of lacrosse. Who you got?
This is
also very interesting for our pick segment for the NLL season, because if this series goes 3 and I go 3-0, you go 0-3, we tie for the season. Which then, how the fuck do we determine a tiebreaker? We'll figure that out if we get to a game 3.
I don't think we're going to have to worry about that. Not because I think some team is going to sweep, but I think I'm smart enough to at least get one of these games right. Maybe not, because I've only gotten one postseason game right.
Go back to your conference finals.
I think I've gotten 2 postseason games right in the entire postseason. Oh. So I'm not going to go out on a limb and say it like that. But this first game is extremely tough. Honestly, for most of the reasons we just named. But the toughest thing for me is really that idea that if Colorado were to somehow go into Bandit Land and pull one off, their chances of sweeping and winning this series go through the roof.
Oh, yeah.
Through the roof. And it's like, that's what makes it hard.
And even if they don't sweep, we just saw what they did in the Western Conference Finals, where they lost at home, but then found that extra oomph on the road again and 1-3.
Yeah, so I mean, but I think being at home in the playoffs, mentioning, you know, what happened with the community not too long ago.
Championship revenge tour. People forget Buffalo was in this same spot in 2019 and lost to Calgary.
Yep.
With a lot of these same guys.
So I wouldn't, yeah. I'm going to go Buffalo game 1. I think they started off the right way, but game 2 is going to be interesting.
I had a lot just flowing through my mind right now. Number one, do you think Chaos is going out to watch this game? After their, because they play the early game on Saturday.
That would be bonkers.
But if there's a watch party,
hypothetically, they could make it. They might go. Go.
Well, funny you should say that because I Googled to see how far.
Yeah,
that's it's 4 hours away.
But like with them playing the early game, that game's starting at
7:30. 2:15, and then you know the game goes 2 hours typically because of 48 minutes and then halftime and then timeouts and everything and stuff like that. They're not gonna go.
But I mean, I'm down.
But if they're having a watch party,
we'll pull up. They know we'll pull up.
What up, Jack?
This one's on me this time.
Man, we need to find that out.
ASAP. And then we can go somewhere and try out that hot sauce from Jerry.
This pick is for the content. This pick is for my boys. Going Colorado. This is one of those where if I would have done that pick fucking earlier in the season, it would have been one game closer because if I would have picked Toronto instead of Buffalo, I'm going to take Colorado just for the rooting interests, keeping it even. And I just like the way they're playing right now. I think it also helps a little bit that they played last weekend. They get a little momentum where Buffalo's been off. Not saying that's a bad thing, but I think for Colorado, it's a benefit for them to just keep their legs moving and not losing momentum where Buffalo, it doesn't really affect them one way or another just because they're so talented.
Or does it? I might argue that a fully rested, basically bye week Bandits might be the scariest thing on the planet.
Oh, yeah. I'm saying like it doesn't really hurt them for being off.
Definitely doesn't hurt them. I think it might. I honestly think it might help them.
And I think it helps Colorado that they've just been playing and getting reps without Ryan Lee and being able to kind of keep their winning momentum going.
I think that's the big thing there is the reps without Ryan.
Because there's always those scenarios where it's like, oh, you know, do you want to have the week off? Do you want to keep playing? And like, I think for some teams it helps to have that week off and some teams it helps to keep playing. And I think both of these teams, for the scenarios they're in, it helps them. So I think this is going to be like a fucking heavyweight title match. I think the series goes 3.
It's going to be nuts. I'm just intrigued to see, like, who does it help more? Like, is it a bigger boost for Buffalo to have that time off? Like, not that any of their guys are really old and, like, need that time, but, like...
Maybe Matt Vince, but...
Yeah, like, most of these guys, looking at their roster, most of these guys had a month.
Yeah.
Really, like, 2-3 weeks, really, in between playing and then having to go to training camp. Like, their bodies have to be tired. Like, this week is probably pretty huge. Well needed. Like, then you look at the flip side, Colorado definitely didn't need that week. If they swept, I think we're talking about Buffalo sweeping in two.
Yeah.
And POL Long Island weekend being bananas.
The return.
Of just literally, they should just title that The Return. Like,
that'll be the title episode of Baltimore Week for us.
Yes.
Because I'm interested what those matchups are for the team because Water Dogs are obviously affected by this matchup. Whip Snakes are affected, and Chaos and Archers are affected the most. So, I mean, Chaos have a matchup with Water Dogs. Dylan Ward's going to be like, hey, guys, long time no see. But if it is Long Island, like, and Chaos come back on ABC. Jesus.
It's not good for us.
Not at all. Or is it?
Nah. If they come back that game on ABC.
Off a championship.
As much as I'm a Woods fan, I'm definitely smashing Chaos.
Off a championship, coming back as the defending champs.
Game one is.
It's gonna be that. So the champ is here.
Game one is. Game one's a 19-4 blowout. Just running it.
Well, that's the best question you could ask. It just poured down rain, and their face-off guy face-offed in a tsunami. Deep cut.
All I could think is Lola.
American Ninja Warrior. This episode is going to be off the rails, but that is our pick-up NLL Finals pick-em segment. I'm taking the Mammoth. DJ's taking the Bandits. It's brought to you by Pickup. Go to playpickup.com. Start playing those headlines. Let's have a good NLL Finals. Wrap up a fantastic return to play for the NLL. But like we said, PLL Albany is here. DJ and I will be there Saturday and Sunday. Man, it just feels good knowing that, like, summer road trips are coming back. If gas prices could go down just a bit, that'd be great.
So I can get a decent price plane ticket. This one wasn't too bad, honestly. It wasn't, but yeah, it'd be nice to knock a few hundred dollars off a plane ticket.
We'll be in Albany. Already had some people reach out saying that they're going to be there. Scotty Royster's going to be there, which is very hype.
What up, Scotty?
We got to bring Scott wherever we go. We got to bring Scotty to the NLL Finals watch party.
Oh, yes.
He's coming through.
Yes.
Minio, Alexis Bradley, they got to come. Like, whole squad deep.
We definitely dropped the ball on adding Diggs. That should have been the first tweet we sent out after San Diego lost.
Yeah.
Yo, how you doing, kid?
Sorry about your luck.
You know what would be crazy? Is he throw up this sign and say, go Bulls.
He would use your gif of...
Of me, yes. And say, go Bulls. Be like, San Diego, who? Go Bulls, baby.
I need Redwoods to win by 1,000 this weekend.
We ain't the only ones looking for that. Shout out, Coach Nat.
So many good matchups this weekend. Obviously, Whips Chaos kicks it off. Redwoods Atlas on the worldwide leader. Water Dogs Cannons in a battle of the expansion teams and Chrome Archers. Now, there are some guys that are not going to be available. Obviously, Whips and Chaos across the board. Redwoods, no John Sexton, which sucks big time. And then Archers, the big loss for them is no Grant Aitman. That's a bummer.
And adding that now, I think the Connor Fields not being there is going to be bigger without Grant.
But this is an opportunity with that matchup. We'll go reverse order. We'll start on Sunday, 3:45 matchup, Chrome Archers. This is a huge opportunity for Matt Moore to step up in his first game as a pro and really, like, showcase his talents, because I think Chris Bates is going to use him a lot. With both of those guys being out, you're going to have to rely on somebody with that skill set and that talent to go alongside, you know, the bunk bed boys. I think we're going to see a lot of Ryan Ambler on Sunday, and then obviously Tom Schreiber as well. But I think this is a big game for Matt Moore.
Now the question is, where does Matt Moore play?
Right.
I'm going to go out on a crazy limb here. No one's going to agree with me. Everyone's going to look at me like I'm dumb. And please tweet at me in the Discord, at me in the Twitter communities, wherever you want to at me. But I absolutely 1,000% believe Tom Schreiber should go play down low with Marcus Holman and Will Manny. And they should leave Matt Moore up top. Having that attack background.
Matt Moore just gained a lot of points in my book.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I loved Matt Moore already watching
just
him
seeing his break. Number right what? Here.
I ain't going to pay attention to that part. I ain't worried about that part. I'm looking back at when he was rocking that good old number 5, which he can't wear here.
Right.
In Virginia, in the same colors, ironically. He looked phenomenal.
He's
going
to look smooth in the 11. That's good points in our book here for me, Matt Moore.
Not
so.
Our book, his book.
Make our that, book being the 11 club.
You got points in my book for just being a good lacrosse player, because you're unreal.
He already had those.
Dude's unreal.
He just got, like, bonus points.
His
That's like when you hit double jeopardy.
Big bucks double whammy.
No whammies. Stop.
Double whammy.
You win a car.
That's a double whammy. Literally a double whammy. No more sticks.
That's like Wheel of Fortune when it's like bankrupt, and then the million. He hit the million slot.
He hit that bankrupt twice. He hit both sides of the bankrupt. That's a double whammy right there. But I mean, I love him up top playing in that midfield. That's what the difference for Virginia this year versus, or these past 2 years versus the years before, in my opinion, was Matt Moore playing at X versus playing that midfield role. Yeah. He played. He opened up their offense so much from up top at that midfield role. Doing that doesn't take anything away from your midfield, and it doesn't take anything away from Tom Schreiber.
Right.
Because now, who do you ask your best pole to defend? Down low. Do you ask him to defend Marcus Holman, or do you ask him to defend Tom Schreiber? Mm. And if you do ask him to defend Tom Schreiber, how does he defend Tom Schreiber?
Yeah.
And now you're asking your best pole up top to decide between, you know, Matt Moore and who's the other one I'm thinking of? Yeah, pull those guys. Trey LeClaire's on that
Trey
list.
Trey will be back.
I mean, Ryan Ambler. Ryan Ogheven is going to be huge in their offense. Like, I like the you brought up the young guys. Young guys are going to be big in this, but I think Matt Moore is the biggest. Like,
you know who else is also going to be big? Either Will Jones or Jackson Place, because I totally forgot Warren Jeffrey's out. He's with Colorado.
Yep. It's going to be – I think Jackson Place gets the nod.
Also, did Scott Ratliff change his number?
No.
He wore number 2.
Yes, he did change his number. He did.
That's like mind-fucking me right now, looking at that. I don't like that. I hope that's just an error on the website.
Why?
I hope that's just an error.
Why? Who's coming in?
Nobody. Plus, he's got veteran status. I hope there's just an input error.
There's
got
to be a reason.
Yeah.
I don't think so, though.
That's so weird. That's so weird.
I hate that they have Connor DeSimone as well. I hate that.
Why do you hate it?
Why did they need him? They have Connor Fields. They have Ryan Ambler. They have Ryan Ogheven. All four of them are the same player.
I think that's a Connor Fields
replacement.
Fill-in.
Yeah, but I mean, he's going to stay. I guarantee it. I think even when Connor gets back, he's going to stay, and they have four players that are the exact same. Those two.
Trade bait.
Those mid lineups are going to be crazy because they're going to end up running two-man game, and it's going to be Ryan and Connor Fields, and then Connor DeSimone and Ogheven. And that's good. With what they have down low, even if Ament doesn't come back.
That's also probably why he's there, too.
Yeah.
So he'll be around. Archers are going to be interesting with some of these guys missing, but also, like, you know, this is, like I said last week, this is a big year for them, and they really got to take advantage of a lot of matchups, this one included. But let's talk about the beauties, my league pass squad.
I'm down with these guys. I'm down with these guys.
You seeing the vision.
It ain't even about the vision. It ain't even about the vision. I'm just down.
We got some number updates here, too. We'll start with that. Brandon Nichtern wearing number 20. That's a criminally underused number, I feel like, in lacrosse.
Yes, and it doesn't surprise me.
I don't hate it.
Because he wore something wild at Army, too.
Yeah. I don't hate that.
It was like he wore like 37 or something. He wore something
20
wild.
Is an upgrade over 37.
He wore something wild at Army.
Logan's wearing 12.
Love that. Love that. Before I wore 23, 12 was my
number. It would have been a power move if he wore number 1.
He should have.
Does anybody have that?
No.
That would have been. Yes. Oh, yeah, JT. Okay. I'm fine with that.
But why is JT not wearing 2?
Colin Heacock.
That's right. That's right. Totally forgot about that guy. Not him, necessarily. I just forgot he's wearing 2.
Yeah. That would have been a power move, though. But I'm fine with JT wearing 1 is fucking beautiful.
Oh, I love it.
That's beautiful.
And can we please hurry up and get Nick Grill in a chrome jersey?
Right. Let's see. Any other number updates of note? I don't think so. So we got Chrome. I'm super excited for them. Love the captains. Perfect, you know, handing over of the mantle to John Rannegan and Jordan McIntosh from, you know, Joel White and the Dolphin boy, Sean Galloway. I'm just excited to watch this team play. Like, adding Logan and Brendan to Jackson Merrill, Dylan Malloy, Colin Heacock, Brendan Cavanaugh, who's been getting a lot of running camp from all the tweets from Keegs I've seen. And I always forget how small he is. But I like it. It's like their version of Ryder. So it works. Their midfield is the thing that I'm going to really be paying attention to. Because obviously you have Jordan, you have John Rannegan, Justin Anderson, Kevin Rogers, Mike Messinger on this team. From Saskatchewan Rush. I really, really like that. A lot. I think he's going to fit in really well, especially with Jordan and John, who both play NLL and have that box background. That excites me if you're running those three at the same time. Because then you kind of have a way to combat any sort of box offensive looks and then be able to really throw a box look, you know, when they're running down on offense.
Yeah, and I mean, I like Mike going in on D as well with Ryan Tarasenko. Like,
Yes.
Give me that every single time. Mike is tough, aggressive, going to play great short stick D. And then when it gets out in transition, you know, if he's got it, he can give it off to Ryan, vice versa. Like, I really like what they're doing. This entire team, what they're doing as a team is fantastic. Like,
besides cutting Randy Stotts, which...
Yeah, but I'm really, like you said, I'm really excited to see this team. I think this is team to watch this year. Like,
yeah.
And as crazy as this sounds, they kind of have the most to, like, fail on this year, in my opinion.
This is a... As weird as it sounds, this is like a free play year for Chrome.
Yeah, because this is the best team they've put out ever.
As long as they stay healthy.
It's only been 3 years. Stay healthy. It's only been 3 years, but
also,
this is by far.
James Barclay, buddy, pal, how are you? Love you. I've been a avid supporter of Chrome, avid supporter of the Halifax Thunderbirds. Did you know James Barclay unfollowed OTB today?
No way.
Very disappointed, very sad. Don't know what happened. Don't know if he got hacked. But
I'm going to say that. I'm going to say he got hacked.
We had to reciprocate because I was very disappointed to come across that news. But we can fix it this weekend, James. Jesse Bernhardt obviously back, which is very big for this team. JT making his pro debut. I'm so excited. Mike Manley's back from injury. I think that's huge for their like just defensive like leadership portion of this team. I think Nick Grill's going to get burned, which is exciting. You know, they, not that they're weak defensively, like they just don't have a lot of depth as opposed to other teams. And I think that's going to be the one spot on this team that will be looking for the most, like trying to find cohesive chemistry because they haven't played together. So that's going to be the biggest part of this team is that from the back up where, you know, you haven't had Sean Scannone playing with your LSMs or your defense pretty much at all. Like, Barclay and Mike Manley were the only two defenders on this team last year consistently. So there's going to be a lot of, I think, learning curves there. But offensively, I think it's there. Like, top, you're good. The back end is where there might be some growing pains early on until some chemistry starts flowing cohesively with this unit, and that's just a matter of just getting reps together.
Not playing devil's advocate here, but I might completely oppose you and say that I think defense may end up being their strong point. Just pointing out my team this year, our offense is 1,000 times better than my defense.
Mm-hmm.
But my defense was, one, playing a lot more.
Right.
And two, they kind of understood if we play bad, we are screwed. Like, we have to play better. And I think Chrome is very much in that same scenario. They're going to be playing a lot of defense. They're going to be in some bad scenarios. But the worse the defense plays, the worse they're going to, like, the worse the games are going to be. So, like, they're going to have that in the back of their minds. They're going to be playing a little harder, but also, like you said, everybody's fighting for a spot, so everybody's trying to play their best. There's no solidified spots in the defense. Yeah. Look at the offense. Offense is almost solidified, but my problem is there are so many mouths to feed and so many newcomers that are just as good as the guys that are already there. Who gets PT? Where do they play? How much do they play? Who's more effective? How do you make these decisions?
I think the benefit for their offense, though, is for like the second from like Long Island on, you had the four who are returning of Heacock, Cav, Dylan Malloy, and Jackson Moreau playing together, and now you're just adding two more talented weapons in Logan and Nick Turn into the mix, so you can kind of finally have some switchability and, you know, run different guys together. But I think having those four up top, having played together for a majority of last season, is big. And then the entire midfield is back, like, and you just add Mike Messenger to the mix, which is exciting. And then their D-mids are pretty much the same. You know, you have Will Haas, you have Ryan Tarafanko, who are, like, clones of one another. And then, not that I think the defense is going to be bad. I think it's a lot of good individuals. It's just a matter of, let's see them blend like we saw their offense kind of start to do last year, just on a defensive side of things. And, you know, as talented as he is, we'll see how JT acclimates to the pro game. Like, he hasn't played since, it's been over a year since he's last played lacrosse. So I'm excited. Like, I'm super excited to watch this team. And I'm very excited that Eli Salama won the LSM battle.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of felt like he would.
Yeah,
he was phenomenal for them in that position last year. Played very well, but the offense just it scares me because there's already looking at attack. They've already talked about sliding Heacock up top. He didn't really play well up there. How does that affect him? How does that affect everyone else? Because being Colin Heacock, he's looking at their roster. He's probably the number one guy.
100%.
You can't not put the ball in Colin Heacock's stick. So if he's playing bad, what do you do? You move him down low, he starts playing better, but then, you know, that completely throws off Logan or Dylan because you move them up top. Like, there's so many worries about where the...
I think that's going to be the key with their offense, is just watching how Sudo and company, like...
Navigate that.
Use problem. Their switchability.
Yeah.
And, like, how they put that puzzle together. But I like that the four guys are back. They didn't really take away from them. And then just, I think adding those two guys to the mix isn't as drastic as what we're seeing with just them actually piecing a defense together, plus a brand new goalie. You know, there's going to be growing pains, I think, for Scannone just like navigating in front of a defense that hasn't played together. I think that's going to be more pressure on him to really just be on his P's and Q's and really step up so that way he doesn't lose playing time to Owen McElroy. Scannone's also so much younger than I thought he was.
He's pretty
young. I thought he was like late 20s, but 24.
He's young.
What a time. Oh. I remember when I was 24.
I ain't even 24 yet.
We'll get into the matchup, you know, picking our matchup there.
We didn't bring up Cole Williams, who might end up being the best midfielder on that Chrome team. That's crazy to say, but he just might be. If he plays even half as good as he's been playing in camp, he's going to be the best midfielder on this team.
I'd still put money on Justin Anderson, but I don't hate that statement.
Like
I'm a big JA guy.
I did say might. I said might. But that dude.
That should be the breakdown of their midfield, though.
Yeah.
It should be J-Mac, Messenger, Rannigan, Kevin Rogers, Justin Anderson, Cole Williams.
Okay, where does Logan, Brendan, and Colin fit into that?
I'm just saying
are they a line grouping of their own?
Yeah. that's from the grouping that's listed as midfield on the website, like those three should be.
So
like,
if those be are the two. Three lines, how do you number them? Who's one, two, and three? And why? Well, I shouldn't say why. We could go on a tangent about why. But who's one, two, and three?
Starting wise, like if you're like, here's your starting lineup, I guarantee Rannigan and Jordan McIntosh are going to start.
So subsequently, does Messenger take the face off then?
Maybe.
Because why not? Right?
That wouldn't surprise me. Because he's taken face-offs himself with the Rush. So.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Like, yeah, I don't hate that.
And they don't necessarily take a roster spot with a face-off guy. Mm-hmm. They're taking it with a midfielder who can take face-off.
Yeah, I don't hate that.
And I mean, Connor needs a little bit of a break here and there. And I mean,
he needs a little bit of a fire lit under his ass.
And I might trust Mike Messenger a little more than Kyle Gallagher.
Oh, 100%. No offense to Kyle Gallagher.
Yeah, he hasn't really shown anything in his little bit of time in the league. And that's, you know, no offense, but it just is what it is. Like,
yeah.
I'm actually really intrigued. You're right. League Pass Team of the Year.
Yeah.
League Pass Team of the Year.
The 1 p.m. Sunday matchup is a battle of the expansion teams. Water Dogs and Cannons. We're both very high on the Dogs. We're both very low on Cannons. No offense to Coach Quirk and company, but Water Dogs, they get Eli Gobrek back, obviously. Sorry to Eli for losing. I also love the power move of the Water Dogs only having one captain. Such a power move.
And for it to be Steven DiNapoli.
Steve is so great.
I love Steve. There's like no knock on Steve, but it's like you look at some of the other guys on their roster, and you're like, okay.
Yes.
All right, Steve, what you really got going on?
What you working with?
What you really doing over there?
I actually probably have to pull up the tweeted out roster of Water Dogs because there's a couple guys on their roster who are not playing this year. Still on their roster.
Like half the squad.
I do have to say, shout out to the boy. Recently followed my personal, Charlie Kitchen. He is one of the coaches on St. Augustine Prep down here in South Jersey. They just won the state title yesterday. Charlie wins there. Hype for the boy. Shout out to Charlie Kitchen. The Water Dogs are probably League Pass team number two for me in terms of just like seeing what they're going to do. I feel like they have so much potential to be that one seed again. Just with the talent they have. So this is their roster. Ryan Brown, Liam Burns, Ryan Conrad, Zach Currier, Matt DeLuca, Steve DiNapoli, Eli Gobrek, Jack Hanna, Jake Higgins, Matt Hosick, Connor Kelly, Charlie Kitchen, Christian Mazzone, Kira McArdle, Ben Randall, which remember, Ben Randall shouldn't be on a roster, Rylan Reese, Chris Sabia, Christian Scarpella, Mikey Schlosser, Michael Sowers, Jacob Stover, Zach Tucci, Ethan Walker, Matt Witcher, and Jake Withers. Really solid roster. I forget who. I mean, they cut Reed Bowering, which you and I were very bummed about, as was Mitch Jones.
Yeah, Mitch was a little more than bummed about it. Bro was animated, to say the least.
Beyond animated. I don't know where their player pool releases are.
I think it's right above this one.
Here we go. Jason Reynolds, Reed Bowering, Noah Rack, and Harrison Bardwell have been released to the player pool. So Reed, really the only name of note, no offense to the other guys, but like Reed's name stands out there, obviously. But not too much like notoriety names cut from this team. In terms of guys who were there last year, I just like their roster. They're a really solid team.
Yeah, I love their roster. I mean, they are extremely solid. Couldn't be more excited about this first couple of weeks.
Arguably second best defense, or like defense 1A in my book, behind Redwoods. And
so really three? Defense three, because you got one and one A, or one A and one B with Woods and Whips.
If we're just talking, like, removing LSM from the conversation and, like, D-middies, you can make the argument you would take Water Dogs defense. I think you can make that argument. Not saying it's right or wrong, but I feel like the argument can be made that Liam Burns, Eli Gobrek, Ben Randall, Chris Sabia,
I mean,
has the potential to be as good as that Whipsnakes defense.
I think the like we were talking with Faceoff, like that elite level is with it's those three. That's the elite level of defenses, and then everybody else falls in subcategories below that. Like those are easily the top three defenses in the league and are pretty much interchangeable. I think the one I have my gripe, my rife with the one person that I believe out of these three teams that probably doesn't fit in with the rest. Not going to say his name. You know exactly who I'm talking about. And our faithful definitely know who I'm talking about too. But yeah, other than that one person, I feel like everyone on that list is interchangeable, no matter the team, like very, very solid defensively. A big part of the reason why I think the Dawgs were the two seed last year.
One seed.
They were the one. Yeah. That's right. Atlas ended up being the two.
Because of score differential.
Big part. There it is, score differential. You got a good goalie and good defense, you're probably going to win the score differential battle.
And I think having Jake Withers and like basically Team Canada without Brody Merrill on this team, it's such a benefit for them to have like that unit there. It's going to be interesting. I'm pumped for Matt DeLuca to get a lot of playing time while Dylan Ward's playing in the NLL Finals. I know you're even more hyped.
It's just his Woods tryout. It's literally just his Woods tryout.
You're so disrespectful to Big Gup.
I'm not. Gup can have his time. And I absolutely love Jack Kelly, but like we can all kind of see the end of his career coming soon, and it's not because he's not good enough, but like he's just not playing. Most guys.
Or he's going to end up on an expansion team next year.
There's that, too. If he ends up on an expansion team, I will be the first to celebrate, and I'll probably grab a jersey, TBH. But at the same time, he could end up sticking with the Woods and in, like, 2 years calls it quits because he's just not playing. And, like, as a backup goalie, how often, like, how much are you really going to come and, you know, fly out every weekend to sit the bench? You know, like, eventually he's going to be like, all right, I got other things in my life I can do. And Matt DeLuca is very similar to Timmy T. You're not changing really much style.
Except he's a little bit taller.
That's it. He's got a few inches on him. But, like, as far as the defense, you're getting pretty much the same goalie. Nothing really has to change. He just has to warm up to the new defense.
Matt DeLuca's a starting small forward in the NBA. I do have one concern with the Water Dogs. They had a Q&A with Michael Sowers on the Premier Lacrosse League official Twitter today. Michael Sowers did not respond to our tweet asking if he was an advanced stat nerd or if he's got that dog in him.
Look at him. What do you think?
I personally am of the ilk that Michael Sowers has that dog in him. I just wanted him to confirm it, but we didn't get a response.
Like, let's look at this, right? Ryan Brown, Kieran McArdle. Ben Reeves and Michael Sowers are the attack we have pictures from on the website.
Right.
Two of them look like they got dog, and the other two look like analysts.
I think three of the four have that dog in them.
I'm going based purely off looks, right?
Yeah.
Now. If I just looked at Ryan Brown and Kieran McArdle, I would think that they're analysts. And they think
See,
about
I think
everything.
Kieran's picture, he looked like his eyes got that dog in him.
Man, look at them dudes. Ben Reeves and Michael Sowers are staring through your entire soul.
Kieran's looking through your soul. Kieran's also a teacher. He got that dog in him.
Yeah, facts. You got a solid point there.
Removing Bennett because he's on the holdout list this year.
Mm-hmm.
Do we see more Connor Kelly playing attack rather than midfield this year?
No.
I think there's an opportunity for it.
And I say that because I think Jack Hanna might be a smidget better for that role in this purpose. I think leaving Connor Kelly up top as your like go-to midfielder is the best option for you.
I'm not saying like full-blown, but I think we could see more of it than we have.
I think, yeah, I think we might see some spots of it, but I honestly think taking him out of that midfield like completely diminishes it.
Because you have Ryan Conrad, you have Zach Currier, Jack Hanna, Connor Kelly, Christian Mazone, Scarpello, Schlosser, Ethan Walker.
We may see Walker slide down before anyone else. Yeah. I completely forgot they had him, but like Walker will probably be the one.
Talk about somebody who got that dog in him.
Yeah. Walker will probably be the one to slide down. Not only, you know, playing attack at Denver, but also his NLL time with Georgia.
You think Mikey could?
No. Mikey will stay in mid. He's got too much of a Zach Currier like play style. They could definitely slide him back to play some D. He's got a nice ground ball game, and they won't move him down there. Maybe Christian Mazone might get some time down there as well, if he gets some time.
If he can see with the way his helmet's tilted.
There's a difference between tilt drip and just that.
See, that's how much tilt he's got. Helmet's falling off. All right, guys, welcome back.
Meanwhile,
I'm in my Mazone.
Pull out a good Drenner tilt for y'all. Shout out the
don't let me get in my zone.
Shout out the tilt god Drenner.
Did you see him in the vlog? RJ was like, "What are you doing? Signing your life away?" Pretty much.
I mean, yeah. It is just about. Oh, you want to play for us? You can't play for nobody else. You better ask Nick Grill about that.
We are very high on this Water Dogs squad. There's a lot to be excited about with them if you're a Dogs fan. And it looks like just from scrolling their Twitter, team owners are in town this weekend, so that should be a doozy. Yeah, so they'll be at the games.
See how hard he just snatched at that ball, trying to catch it off the wall. Young fans, snatching at the ball does nothing but ruin your sidewall.
Football players, am I right?
The man.
Let's look at their opponent, the Cannons. A lot of just turnover. We got a jersey update for a new acquisition. Jake Ficar is our number 10. Formerly number 54 with Chaos.
What?
I don't know how I feel about that. We'll report back once we see it in person. There's a lot to just like decompress with this team.
They loaded up on offense for sure.
Which you and I both said, we don't know if we really like agreed with that. Full blown, knowing how we felt about their defense last year. Mm-hmm. And not that their defense is bad. It's just we thought it needed more depth, which you had Scott Hooper, you had Brian McIntosh, you have Jack Kilty, Holden Garland, Brody Merrill, Jake Pulver all coming back. But your offense was super solid last year. Like, having Drenner, Shane Jackson, Lyle Thompson, that was what we felt like the best running offense they had last year. You added Ryan Tierney in trade. You drafted Asher Nolting. You added Christian Cuccinello last year, like halfway through. You have Adam Charlin-Beads coming in. Brendan Bomberry, I don't know if he's playing or not. Like, he's supposed to play MSL, but MSL is delayed because of a ton of reasons. Brendan Bomberry's got a number on the website, too, which I think is an indication that he's going to be playing, which is exciting because you have a Georgia Swarm attack line that you can run with Lyle, Shane Jackson, and Brendan Bomberry. It's just a lot of guys on this roster, and I don't know. Let me pull up Cannon's official 25-man roster.
Is it Tierney on that?
Tierney's on their roster. Let's see.
No, isn't Tierney on that Georgia team as well?
I don't think so. I could be wrong, though. So the guys that made it, so the attack, the guys that they're listing at attack, I should say, which is very interesting as well. Christian Cuccinello, Shane Jackson, John Piatelli, Steven Rifas listed at attack, Lyle Thompson. Midfield, Brendan Bomberry, Adam Charlin-Beads, Drenner, which is very interesting, Fricaro, Asher Nolting, Nate Solomon, Ryan Tierney. let's just decompress that, because that's the biggest, like, additions and everything. Drenner being listed at midfield makes zero sense to me.
Makes a ton of sense to me.
Simply because, like, played so well on the wing last year.
Yeah, but looking at who they have listed at attack, we know Lyle and Shane are going to start.
I'm just saying flip-flop Drenner and Rufus, because we saw Rufus run out of the midfield last year when obviously Paul was there, but I felt like that's where Steven shined the most in terms of, like, nobody was, like, giving him any attention, so he could just go.
But now what I think they were worried about is him getting all the attention. Slide him down at attack. Teams are normally a little slower to slide to their DIs. They leave them out on islands a lot. That's arguably a better matchup. Getting Drenner on a short stick at any time is a goal 98% of the time. And he can still take that pull from up top. I kind of think it flexes the offense more. And Rufus and Piatelli have much more similar game styles than Drenner does to either one of them. So I think that might be why, is more of when they go for that change because one of them isn't working, or, you know, whatever the case may be. It's a lot more similar between Piatelli and Rufus than it would be between Drenner and one of the two. There's just so many reasons why they could have done this.
Can I also just say, I personally don't feel like Ryan Drenner fits this team.
Then what team does he fit?
Like,
because I love him on this team.
I feel like he's always just so, like, lost in the shuffle. Because obviously it's Lyle's team, which makes a ton of sense. But, like, I don't know. I feel like Drenner, I feel like he caught a very shitty hand with the Water Dogs. And that sucked, because I thought, like, he could have been, like, the face of that team. I mean, if, I don't know. It's just one of those weird things where it's like, damn, like, he's moved from team to team a ton. Like, this is his third team since the league started. This is the second year he's been on a team consecutively, which is good for him, I'm sure. But there's just so many mouths to feed on this attack and midfield grouping that I just don't know how it's all going to mesh.
This is going to be wild when Rufus, Jackson, and Lyle step out at attack, and their first midline line when they go on offense for the first time is Drenner, Bomberry, and Asher.
Mm-hmm. And or Adam Charlepiece.
Or, I mean, even Jake Ferraca or Ryan Tierney. Like, you can put out six guys, and you're legitimately asking two short sticks to play defense on a guy they cannot play defense on. The offense is in, like, it's in great shape. It's the defense that is, in fact, the problem. Like,
and keeping three face-off guys for your 25-man roster, and I know Cannon struggled. I know Cannon struggled last year. But, man, not being able to really make a determination of which two guys played the best in camp is, oof, yikes.
Yeah. I think they put too much on their goalies.
Yeah.
I think they put too much on their goalies. The offense is, you know, loaded, and they do fine, because, I mean, they put up plenty of goals last year. They weren't hurting for points, but you're asking Nick Morocco and or Colin Kearse to make a lot of saves this year. That's tough. That's going to be tough.
That's going to be an interesting matchup, to say the least, which we'll get into in a little bit. Let's go to the game that's on the worldwide leader. Redwoods, Atlas. Come on. Team's loaded. Redwoods are loaded.
Is Timmy changing his number?
I don't know. There's some guys that are, like, listed on each team's website that have been there, and then, like, their number's not there. So I don't know if they're still just, like, inputting them, but I feel like Timmy's sticking with zero, which I love.
That'd be wild if he popped out with a different number.
I don't like that.
That's got to be wrong.
That's got to be so wrong.
But then again, it might not be.
I don't like that.
Because he wore some stupid number in college, too. Like,
that is so bad for the jersey analytics.
He wore, like, 66 or something. No. No, what did he wear? 36?
So
I think he wore 36.
That's so bad.
I'm almost positive he wore 36.
Which, like, isn't that terrible? Like, Finn Sullivan pulls 36 off.
But so does
60?
So does Zed.
Yeah.
Zed
makes, 36 is an okay
Zed
number.
Zed makes 36 look fire.
It's not the best.
It's an awful number, in my opinion.
But
who wears
there
36?
Are some guys.
Who wears 36 in any sport?
Brian Westbrook pulled it off.
Okay, yes. I'll give you that.
There's some, like, we got, like, it's a certain type of player.
We got Zed and Brian Westbrook. That's about
and
it.
And Finn Sullivan. I'll give Finn Sullivan that credit.
I like Finn, so yes.
He just needs to change his shoes up. The shoe sock game needs to be switched up. But
it's better than the feet of some other guys.
We'll talk to him.
I'm going to leave him alone now.
But, man, that's not great for the jersey analytics of Arden Code. We're talking about Arden Code, everybody.
Yo,
our pride and joy wearing number 60.
Did you just see what number that guy's wearing?
Oh, yeah.
Fire.
Yeah, Nekai Montgomery's wearing number 1.
Fire. But now my question is, what does DeMayo wear?
He wore 16 at Maryland?
Yeah. Mm. 32. Double it up.
Do we have a 32?
I don't think so.
I don't hate that. That's what he should have been wearing.
Yeah, that would have been a better number for him. A Thunder.
That's going to be a bummer if we walk out there.
I really don't think he's wearing that. I really do think that's a input error.
Oh, God, I hope so. That would be so bad.
That would
be
awful.
So bad.
That would be awful. Also want to know what number Joe Robertson's going to wear.
Yes.
His number is available as far as I know. He wore 8.
Eight
at Duke, yeah.
That's what Arden should have been wearing,
unless Nat retired it in honor of Kobe. Wouldn't be surprised. Was like, yeah, I mean, you could wear 8, but you ever heard of Kobe, bro? Nah.
You ain't him.
You ain't.
That's the number that Arden Cohen should have been wearing. He should have to fight Ryan Hollenbeck in a duel with lacrosse sticks, like fucking medieval times.
Okay, so now, do you give Ryan Hollenbeck a pole, or do you give Arden Cohen a short stick? It has to be fair, yes?
I just give Arden Cohen number 24. We call it a day.
I mean,
that would have been fantastic for the jersey analytics.
For the sake of content, if they're going to fight, like, I would assume we give Arden a short stick.
It's got to just be fencing with fucking lacrosse sticks.
Right, but like, it's got to be fair. Like, right now, it's Arden with a pole against Ryan with a short stick.
And we want Arden to win, okay?
Awful. I'm trying to be the nice guy here, make things all fair. You're
Ryan,
not.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
There's other cool numbers for you out there,
yes.
Ryan. You can take 12. We don't have a 12.
Anyway. Well, if he's wearing 24, what is he wearing? And by he, Clark Peterson.
Is he going to go back to 45?
Well, he's on the pup list, so I don't know what he's going to wear, but Ryan Lee was 45. So I don't know. I don't know if, like, him being on the pup list affects that.
I don't think Ryan Lee's going to play this year.
Yeah, I doubt it.
So I think maybe that affects it for just this year. Because, I mean,
I'd be fine with that. Clark looked fine in 45.
After seeing the jersey reveals, not necessarily impressed or not impressed, but they kind of just, you know, slapped a champion logo on the old stuff. Like, I would assume next
champion
year,
logo looks dope.
Yes,
for everybody out there. Just said, like, the reason I said it looked dope and for whatever fucking reason got eviscerated on Twitter. fuck all of you. It's like that gel looking like puffed up material, and I think that's fucking sick. Like the Adidas one who's stitched, this looks cool. I'm a fan.
Yeah, I mean, I like it. I'm not opposed to the champion.
It's so big, you can see it from outer space.
That's the point.
Yeah, you fucking idiot. It's called a brand deal.
Hello.
Get with the times.
They don't, you know, make all this stuff for free.
I'm also on the Redwoods official Twitter account. They did a Q&A with Isaiah Davis out, and someone said, could you take a hit from at Mike Tyson? Quote, it depends on how much you're paying me. I'd take it, but I don't know if I would be awake after.
All time tweet.
We've talked about this Redwoods team a ton, obviously, because it's our squad. Very excited. The only concern we have is that Kyle Hartzell's the only LSM.
But like I said, I think Ryan Kennedy's going to slide up and play some there.
And it's not that like we think Hartzell's bad. It's just, one, he's older. Two, to only have one guy listed at a certain position when you need depth across the board at every position in this league is just like, huh, what's the catch here? Drew Simoneaux gets the backup faceoff spot as well, which I liked. He played well in the playoffs.
But also, I think the one LSM thing might be to leave a spot for
John Sexton,
who is expected to make a return once his injury heals up. So it's not, it may not necessarily be a
who gets cut one for LSM Sexton. Thing. Might just be a performance-based thing.
It's gonna be a MIDI.
Yeah.
And it might be a D-mid. Might be Hallenbeck.
Or Jack Dolan.
Dolan didn't make the
25. Oh, he didn't make it. Who did we...
We kept Hallenbeck.
Here we go.
Here in Davis Island.
Okay.
I think Hallenbeck might get cut just because you can run a Surge or a Miles.
Yeah.
Bertrand, maybe someone out in the Kai at D-mid and give him an old mid run right after kind of thing. But I don't think you want to take out a D guy to replace with a D guy.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, we might see Arden play some LSM early in the year too.
True.
I mean, guy's good. He's fast. He can move.
Playing Atlas, you've been impressed by them. I haven't really been able to tap in too much to the training camp stuff.
More than impressed.
Some jersey analytics updates. Chris Gray in 24. Sensational.
Not surprised for
Brennan Curry in 16.
Not a surprise at all.
Any updates?
Max Wayne hasn't gotten a number yet. Neither has Kobe Smith.
Which we've been led to believe Kobe's wearing number 0.
Oh, wait. Yes. Yes, we do know that. Sorry. So, that is not a lead. That is a fact. He said that himself in a vlog. PLL vlog. He was like, I'm wearing number 0. And I was like, oh, okay.
Cool. Okay.
We like that.
Yeah. Steez.
He's actually going to look icy in the 0.
Yes. Big fan of that. Just not a fan that he's on Atlas because he's a stud.
Like, can you get him in that purple jersey with the 0 with the baby blue helmet?
Can we just know when they're wearing those jerseys, please?
Like, they're honestly, they have a great colorway to kind of mash it. Go light blue helmet, purple jersey, white shorts. Gas.
Be sick with cream shorts, though. Be sick with cream shorts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this roster's loaded with 10. Like, this is the roster we say, like, all the time. They just add talent to it, no matter what position they are. Their attack that they've been running typically has been Eric Law with Jeff T and Chris Gray on the wings, which is... That's some fucking Madden create a team shit. But this is going to be a fun matchup.
Yeah. The wildest thing in my mind is that things could go completely south and they decide to flip Jake Caraway and Jeff Teat and run Jeff Teat out of the midfield. And that is so scary.
And they still have Dan Bucaro behind them.
There is not an LSM in this league that can guard Jeff Teat.
No.
And there's definitely not a short stick who can do so.
No.
Like, and this then, roster.
Like, waiting in the wings behind those three is Jake Caraway and Dan Bucaro.
Yeah. This roster is scary. Scary.
Yeah. Like, their midfield, if they wanted to, they could just go Caraway, Bucaro, and Romar. If they wanted to. Like, they have that ability to do that. Not saying they will. But that's stupid. And they also have Dax Aitken just chilling playing midfield, where on almost any other team, he'd be playing attack.
Dude. Could you imagine, like, Romar, Brian, and Jeff with Jake, Chris, and Eric down low? Yikes.
Anyway. But anywho.
Low-key, dark horse for Depoy. Michael Rexrode on that list.
I wouldn't even say dark horse.
I picked him up.
I think he's a favorite.
I picked him up this week for fantasy.
Yeah, absolutely. If you guys are not playing
smashed it.
Player Royale, challenge us.
ASAP.
Play everybody.
I was like, yeah, dude.
I tried to send... I don't know if it was just like they were updating the app, or I tried to send challenges to people or like accept challenges and it like wouldn't load them, which was annoying, but hopefully it works.
But yeah, no, this...
Roll Woods.
I couldn't believe Michael Rexrode was a tier two.
Yeah, that was crazy to me.
Dude led the league and caused turnovers until week like 8.
Yeah.
How is he a tier two? Because my homie goes, how is Rambo a tier two? I was like, I think it's based off of last year's stats. And like, it makes a lot of sense for Rambo to be tier two. He missed quite a bit of time, so his numbers were lower because he had the hand injury. And I'm going to tell y'all right now, I'm going to be tapping into Rambo as a tier two because that's a steal. Because the man's going to pop off at least the first 2 weeks of the year, if not three, depending on what's going on with Zed. And he'll probably have to keep that going a little bit until Zed gets acclimated. We're talking about Rambo having 4, 5, 6 points a game for the first 4 or 5 weeks of the season. Like,
yeah.
If you need somebody to pick up at attack for tier two or lower, well, for tier two, Rambo's definitely a guy to look at.
Yep. And speaking of Rambo, Whips Chaos is the first matchup. It's the last one we're talking about here. Looking at Whips, pretty chalk, I'd say, for who makes their 25 man. Just very, very Whips.
Yeah, very D heavy.
Which doesn't surprise me. They like having the options there. I mean, they're loaded again.
Yep. Yep, didn't expect it. I mean, my biggest question mark with this team is, and it's not even a bad question mark, is Wheaton Jacoboys.
Yeah.
Are they going to play him on some D runs? Is he only going to play offense? Are they going to put him in any kind of scenarios he played in at Notre Dame? Like, that man on the inside was unreal.
My question, too, with Zed out for, you know, at least 2 weeks, would you try Gutty up top with Rambo and Jay Carlson at all?
No. I like Gutty up at midfield, giving them some different looks up there, taking that pole.
Typically Rambo's playing outside with Zed playing at X.
Okay, I do. I put Justin down just to see if teams will pull Mike Chanichuk.
Yes.
If they let them pull him then.
Because obviously we've seen Gutty in this league thrive playing X.
Yeah.
Like, he did it in 2019 with Chrome, and then the bubble happened, and then last year Chrome was just in a really weird spot and traded him.
Yeah. I think if you can
Would try it at least. Like, what do you have to lose playing Gutty at X and then having Rambo and Jay Carlson in their normal positions?
I mean, you don't lose anything. I think you just gain an advantage to have Mike get pulled and pull out the pole.
Mm-hmm.
Get some good short stick matchups with Brad Smith,
especially Brian with Cole, Brian Cole being back,
Connor Kurse, Jacoboys. Like, those are guys that can definitely, you know, take a guy off the dodge
Yeah. Especially a short stick if the poles pulled out on Chinatown.
And then you have Brad Smith, too.
And we have Chris Aslanian. I mean, Chris Aslanian's nice.
Yeah.
Very nice, honestly. I don't know who's better, him or Pat.
Whips are loaded. And then...
You see Pat get away with that cross-check to the neck.
I love how everything like that happens. And then Pulski on Twitter is just like, everyone's telling... Anybody said it? Shut up. He's like, nah. He doesn't think anything's a foul.
He's like, nah, that's clean. Clean.
It's so funny. We're laughing at the team question about which players they wouldn't let date their daughter from Chaos, and apparently Jack Rowlett's hair equals bad boyfriend material.
That's a fire backpack.
Where is... Here's the roster. So... The, I guess you could say, piece together Chaos roster. There's a lot to look at, and I totally forgot Donville's on this team. God damn. They're loaded even with not all their guys here. I love that for them. Man.
Like we brought up 1,000 times, like the hardest part is going to be, or not even the hardest part, the most interesting part of this team is who gets cut when everybody comes back.
Yeah.
Who stays, and is it based off of
performance? Is it
based off this year's performance, or do past performances come in at all? Does past team dynamic come in at all? Like, you know, like there's so many other factors you could bring in from years past, having 2 years already, especially winning a championship last year, or three years already.
Yeah.
And having won a championship, like, you can't just diss those guys. Like,
yep.
You got to respect them. So it's like, but if a new guy comes in and outshines them, where does,
right,
you know, how does that conversation go?
Jared Newman, a captain this year. Shout out to the boy.
Like that.
Jared Glick and Blaze. Jersey analytics for some of the new guys. Zach Geddes wearing number 13. Donville wearing number 5. Wasserman getting the 77. Okay. My boy Brett Kennedy getting number 11. Good shit. Welcome to the club. Did CJ Cospiel wear number 9 all season last year?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
For some reason, I'm thinking Troy used to be 77.
Yep.
Interesting. Okay. I like this Chaos team even without all their guys. Solid ass squad. They're gonna score even with this team. There's a bunch of guys who have experience, playing either in the PLL or in the MLL. They're gonna go. Like, as silly as it is, it's like Bryce Wasserman won the last MLL MVP award. So to have that as like a replacement player almost is wild.
Tommy Palisak, like
Tommy P, TP84.
Right? There's some good guys out there. Ty Thompson's on this list.
Like, Bubba Voigt.
Matt Reeves made the list.
And this is a good spot for, you know, the Ryan Smiths and the Tanner Cooks, mm-hmm. Kyle Jackson, where like they're gonna have a lot more time to shine in these opportunities. Mac O'Keefe. This is big for them, in my opinion. But let's get to our PLL picks of the week, also brought to you by Pickup. First one, we'll just go in order of, you know, start time. So Whips, Chaos, the replacement champions against the two-time champions. How you see this one going down, Deej?
This is the hardest game of the week to pick.
100%.
Both teams, ironically, are heavily affected. Looking at the Whips roster, there aren't a lot of pieces missing. But with a name like Zed Williams, and as good as he is, that's a big piece missing. But I think the real key to who wins this game is defenses and goalies. Mm-hmm. Both of these teams have their full defenses. Both of these teams, outside of Ian McKay, but
then, yeah,
you know, that's a big drop, but not a huge
for
drop.
Sure.
You know, both these teams have their full defenses and their starting goalies. I believe Chaos's defense and starting goalie is better than Whipsnake's defense and starting goalie, and that's why.
From the last time we saw them, we should say.
Yes. I think putting out Jack Rowlett,
Jared Newman,
and Brett Kennedy is going to be unreal.
Matt Reese
could possibly take that spot. Like,
was he there last year?
No.
So he's back. Basically, him and Johnny Serdik kind of flip-flop.
Yep. So I like what they have going. I think their defense and goalie will hold it together enough to win. But, like I said, Rambo's probably going to pop off because he's going to have to.
Rambo.
And he's going to have to.
And he likes playing against his former roommate. I agree with you. I'm taking Chaos here. I like the biggest thing that's going to determine this game is how well Chaos is able to operate off of losing faceoffs, because we know, no offense to Tommy Kelly or Jerry, they're going to lose faceoffs to Joe. Like, Nards is going to win a bunch of these faceoffs. It's just a matter of how can Chaos transition out of them and, you know, get a quick defensive shift out to stop this Whipsnakes offense that, even without Zed, is fully locked and loaded and can put up points. That's my biggest thing I'm watching in this game, is how well Chaos responds off of losing faceoffs, as opposed to, you know, not that you're going into it with a mindset of, oh, we're going to lose them, but on paper, you're more than likely going to lose more faceoffs than you're going to win. So that's my big thing here, but I think Chaos has enough firepower and enough defensive prowess to win this game. ESPN primetime, 5 p.m., Redwoods, Atlas. Need this to be a rivalry. Like, I need fucking oxygen to breathe. Roll Woods. On to the next one.
Punch it. No questions asked.
Bang.
You already know what it is.
Water Dogs, Cannons, Battle of the Expansion Teams. I think we both agree on this one. Water Dogs. I think this is going to be a very high-scoring game. Both offenses have so much talent that are going to put up so many points. And this is no slight at Matt DeLuca either. It's just like, you're facing Lyle Thompson, Ryan Drenner. Like, there's just so many names that that's who I'm watching in this matchup, just to see how well he responds to the plethora of talent he's going to be facing. But I think Water Dogs have enough to combat it. I think Water Dogs have the better face-off unit as a whole, not just Jake Withers, whole unit together. And Water Dogs win this one in a high-scoring affair.
Yeah, I think it comes down to the defense. I think Water Dogs' defense is going to make a few more plays than the Cannons' defense will, and that's what's going to win them the game. But I do think it's really tough for Matt DeLuca to be stepping in and for this to be his first, like, real PLL action.
Yeah.
Is to play Lyle Thompson.
Like, that's got one start tough in the bubble, and that was it.
Yeah. And, I mean, this season was just about made up at that point, so it wasn't like yeah, they were being competitive, but it isn't going to be what you're going to get week one.
Right.
Lyle Thompson. Like, we're going to see exactly what Matt DeLuca's made of. And I'll tell you right now, Nat, this man plays well. You better sign him.
Chrome Archers to wrap up the weekend. No Grant, which sucks, but it's League Pass team versus team that's on watch this year. This is the second tough, like, 1A toughest. Because I think without Grant, there's a lot of similarities offensively that these teams have the firepower to go back and forth with. And the face-off thing is tough because it's a rookie against a guy who needs a little kick in the ass. And we love Connor Farrell on this show. Just want to see him back to that 2019 level of performance. I'm going to take Archers because I like their goalie situation, as well as their defense situation in front of Gitz. not saying that Chrome can't win this game. I just think the chemistry of Archers going into this one helps them a lot. And even though they don't have Warren Jeffrey and don't have Grant, they still put up points in 2019 without Grant Ament on this offense. And I think they can still put up points, especially when you have arguably best player on the planet, Tom Schreiber, on your team. So I'm going to go Archers.
For me, this one's a little bit easier. It is still tough without Grant and obviously league pass team that I really like with a lot of good players, a lot of young talent being good. But the thing for me is young and old. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't even say old. I'd say veteran, skilled, been here, done that. Like the experience that is on the Archers with Tom Schreiber, Will Manny, Marcus Holman, Matt McMahon,
Scotty Ratliff,
you know, Gitz, Drew Adams,
Dominique Alexander,
Treese,
Mark McNeil.
Like the list literally goes on and on. Every single guy, you know, pretty much every single guy you name on the roster that isn't a rookie has played a good amount of professional lacrosse. And like in these scenarios, that matters, especially when you lose your number one guy. You know, essentially, Grant Ament is the best lacrosse player on this team.
It's perennial MVP candidate.
Like. And without him, that's a big difference. So to have all that experience of guys that know what to do and to have a guy like Tom Schreiber and or Matt Moore to be the one to fill those shoes of the guy you're missing, you're not really missing too much. So I think Archers will be okay. And like you said, Cromer's still kind of trying to find themselves both on offense and defense, kind of just all.